Dance Monkey. Yes, this is the song I want to look at today. And before you frown like I did when I looked at the top of the charts this week, bear with me because there's more behind this song than it might seem on the surface. At first, we will look at the harmony and melody of this song. The melody is important here because the harmony is pretty simple and the melody gives it a kind of upgrade. Then in the second part, we will look at the lyrics and the background of the song, which is important, I think, to understand that this song is not as simple as it might seem on the surface. And then in the third part of this video, I want to touch on the topic of multi-layered songwriting. So creating songs with various layers of meaning so that you can address multiple audiences at the same time and be successful. So let's start with part one, harmony and melody. So first the chords. There are only four chords here, so this is very simple. The chords are all diatonic, meaning they are all from the same key, which is F sharp minor. So the first one is the tonic, F sharp minor. Then moving to D major, then to E major, and to C sharp minor. And then back to starting from the beginning to F sharp minor. So first one is the tonic, minor tonic. Then we have a kind of subdominant, because this is the relative major of the minor subdominant. So in F sharp minor, the subdominant would usually be B minor. And the relative minor of B minor is just a minor third up, which is D major. So that's what we're using here. So essentially, from a functional harmony point of view, this is tonic to subdominant. Then we move to E major, which again is the relative minor of C sharp minor, which is the dominant function in minor. So moving from tonic to subdominant to dominant, staying on the dominant because we're just moving from E major to C sharp minor. So just a move from the relative major to the relative minor. So functional harmony is just tonic, subdominant, dominant, dominant. Pretty simple, right? The only thing here is that we use a few relative chords, and it's all in minor, and it's all in natural minor. So some of you might be used to melodic and harmonic minor, where the dominant chord is actually a major chord, so like this. But that's too fancy for the song, so it's just natural minor, where the dominant chord, or the chord on the fifth scale degree, is also minor. So that was it for the harmony. Pretty simple. Also, the voicings are very simple. So there's no nothing. They are just root position. Very simple. It's like someone just practicing or learning how to play the piano, or it's just some arpeggiator used for a chord grip, and then it just uses the chords. So very simple, nothing fancy to it. What then makes it interesting, what makes the harmony interesting, is the melody. Because the melody adds a few options that you might not expect from, if you heard in the intro, the simple harmony, just the simple chords. So the melody goes a bit like this. I don't have the exact melody, but here you see the first interesting tone already. And then it goes something like this. Yeah, then we get to this. So the first interesting note in the melody is this on the second chord. This one. It's a real bite to it. Wonderful note. So if you look at the melody as just like being kind of the natural minor scale, then it's totally in line with that. It's just the ninth of the scale, or the second degree of the scale. But because we have a D major chord underneath, then that scale degree, which is a G sharp, is essentially the sharp 11 of the chord. And this sharp 11 is typical for Lydian chords. So the chords on the subdominant chords on a major scale have the Lydian scale attached to it. So you can use other scales, but the most natural one, if you just use the notes of the scale, then it's the Lydian scale, which gives it that distinct subdominant quality. And the melody ends on that note, so it's really pointing to it. It's you really hear that note. And if you listen to Tones and I singing this, he actually bends the note around quite a bit. So as it's supposed to sound off somehow, a little off. And but it's not too much off. It's very interesting. So when we get to the layered meanings of the song, we'll get back to this. And then it's basically it ends on the same note, the G sharp, the second phrase. The first phrase. And then the second phrase is something like. Ends on the same note, but this time the note doesn't have that bite because it's simply a chord tone of the dominant, chord tone of the C sharp minor. So this is interesting to learn. The same melody can be pretty boring or predictable, or it can have an interesting character and a bite to it. And it's the same melody, but it's the chords underneath that make the difference. So this is why you should always, always think of harmony and melody as something that belongs together. I mean, everything in a song, even also the rhythm and other parts belong together. But too many times I see people just compose that in isolation. So they write down some chords, then they write down a nice melody that fits over these chords, and then it tends to be boring, because if you have the harmony and then just write a melody that fits, well, what does the melody really add to it? But if you have a melody that has its own character and then find certain points where the melody fits the harmony and then certain points where the melody kind of challenges the harmony, that's what makes it interesting. And if you're then writing a real good song, then you put these tension points, these points where harmony and melody have an interesting, let's say, interesting relationship, put them on the points in the song where you want people to listen. So the melody then goes on for the second part and it goes higher. So here in that part, It resolves that tension, that Lydian tension. Yeah, it's circling the note that it wants to reach from G sharp to E, then to F sharp. So circling that note is something you should also have in your bag of tricks for writing melodies. Circle the note before you hit it. makes it more interesting. What I find interesting here is that it resolves the tension. So it doesn't stay on that interesting note. And then goes on. I don't know exactly, but I know it ends on... It ends on an A over a C-sharp minor chord. Which, again, gives that a different character. It's the same chord, but then... I mean, apart from being a minor second away from the fifth of that note, of the C-sharp minor chord, it also kind of turns that into a different chord. If you listen to it... That's different from... Because that has that six chord feel, where you have a different inversion of the chord. So this is, some people call that the first inversion, which is if you have a third in the bass of a chord, like an A major chord here. And traditionally it's called a sixth chord or 3/6 chord, because you have a third and a sixth in that chord. And these chords are very interesting. I love these chords. Because having the third in the bass is essentially an A major chord, but it makes it unstable. This chord always wants to move. For me, it always wants to move up half step. Like to that. It always wants to move up. And we have that here as a variation. And before that, you also notice that it uses like the fourth and it alternates between the fourth and the third of the dominant chord, the relative major of the dominant chord, which also makes that chord a little unstable. Because usually you resolve that tension once and you stay there. But this is kind of intentionally creating some tension, not so nice sounding notes, and making it unstable, which is great. You have to, for your songs, you have to move between having stable harmony and melody and then having unstable parts. Where you can notice this technique to balance between stable and more unstable and back to stable and unstable best is probably when you listen to drum fills. Because drummers, usually they have a solid beat going on. It's just, there's no tension. But then there's these things called breaks or fills. When the drummer moves away from that solid backbeat right before a different part happens, like right before the chorus. Then they move away and it's like almost like they are stumbling. So they are putting you off balance from the backbeat intentionally, only to then create some tension and then let you land back on the backbeat on the next beginning of the next part. The same thing that drummers do, we can do with harmony and melody. So make it a little more unstable to then give to create some tension. This keeps your listeners at the edge of the seat a little, so that they listen and really pay attention to the important parts of the song. So the last part then about harmony and melody is looking at the chorus, which has then again a simpler melody, more stable melody. And you might notice that it ends on the third of the D major chord, not on the sharp 11, but now it's stable. It ends on the third. It plays along with the rules. So then the chorus is a little more... The chorus plays by the rules. No interesting notes there. So it does what you want it to do. And that, again, that will become interesting in the third part of this video when we talk about multi-layered songwriting and multiple meanings in a song. But now, to understand the multiple meanings, we have to first take a short look at the lyrics and at the background of the song and what the Tones and I says about what this song means.